Welcome to Stepping Stones to Awareness with Liz Watson, Shadow Banking Regime with Caroline Stevens. Microphone's going hot.
Welcome to a Stepping Stones for Awareness program. I'm Caroline Stevens, and today I'm interviewing Liz Watson about the Shadow Banking Regime. Now, Liz has a very interesting tale to tell. Liz is actually the daughter of a member of a bank staff. And Liz has also got her own banking tale to tell, a tale of woe, in fact. So, Liz, welcome to Wiltshire. Welcome to the Basis Project, Stepping Stones. And over to you. Please tell everybody at home your story and why they should be very afraid.
Thank you. Yes, I want to basically give the main message that shadow banking is not being addressed by the Treasury.
Could I just interrupt you there? What is shadow banking to, you know, most people probably just go into their bank branch, they have their current account, they may have a deposit account, they'll have their mortgage account. What do you mean by shadow banking?
Well, shadow banking is basically like a dual system. It's where you've got the real bank and you've got the...
Like the high street bank?
Yep. And then you've got the fake bank, which is the shadow bank, which is trading off the real bank's name, but is not on the ledger of the bank, so it can't be audited with the National Audit Office. It's that bad. So what they're doing is they're running what we call, what they call escrow accounts or clone accounts, and they're setting up using fake sort codes, false account numbers, fraudulent numbers. They set them up without a mandate of authority, and it could happen to anyone. You could wake up in the morning like I did, and I discovered I had 10 fraudulent bank accounts set up in mine and my husband's name, licensed to steal, no mandate of authority, goes into autopilot, and if you're not careful, you could lose your shirt and your home and everything you own. And it's the most disgusting scam of the century. It doesn't seem to be talked about. Nobody's looking at the forensic evidence to see, well, where's the mandate authorising this account to be opened in my name? It's like, excuse me, I have actually telephoned Lloyds Banking Group,
Basically, Lloyds Bank Group have got high street branches all over the country, and yet they've got this pseudo Lloyds Bank trades off the back of.
Yeah, will it happen before the merger, actually? The particular shadow bank, I don't know how many they've got. They might have 50 for all I know, any unknown number. But the particular shadow trading entity that's ruined the lives of me and my family and 400 other fellow victims I know of is trading as In Parallel Solutions. And I've spoken to a Lloyds whistleblower who actually had run-ins with Fraser Mackay, who ran In Parallel Solutions out of the private banking unit in Manchester office of HBOS PLC. And In Parallel Solution actually appears on the paperwork that I've got, some of the paperwork. And it was run ultra vires of the law, ultra vires of the banking charters, the banking codes. It is ultra vires of the legal system. And it's ironic that we've had our lives absolutely hijacked by a big name law firm, Eversheds, now trading as Eversheds Sutherland. And I know they've done this to lots of people, particularly the Cardiff office, it seems. They've basically been working hand in glove with criminals inside of the banking fraternity of HBOS PLC, now trading as Lloyds Banking Group.
So do any of the staff, are they aware of the situation?
Well, actually, let me correct that. HBOS PLC is now trading as Bank of Scotland PLC, but nobody talks about the dark secret that actually the shadow entity of In Parallel Solutions resulted in $250 million going missing. American dollars went missing in 2002 and has never been traced. And the Serious Fraud Office put out a press release in April 2008 or so, stating there was more than £100 million, well, $233 million went missing and not been accounted for. And I discovered through the most Kafkaesque nightmare ever over the past 10 years, since Eversheds came on the scene, interestingly, that Fraser Mackay was opening up an unknown number of fake bank accounts, which all were ultra-viries of the ledger and obviously can't be audited. In other words, creating unregistered debt. An unregistered debt is not debt you can regulate because it's not on the ledger. So the courts have no jurisdiction. So what Eversheds did was they conned us that we were debtors and that we, you know, that they were acting for the bank, meaning Bank of Scotland. And we never had a contract with the Bank of Scotland. And it's just a horror story. It's like they go for you in the most ruthless way imaginable.
So you found that through information coming through the letterbox, you had 10 accounts set up with...
Actually, not all with HBOS. I found out in 2016 the picture started to unravel. Unfortunately, by that stage, I'd had a fraudulent order for possession put on my house by a very bent judge called Martin Allen Gordon Dancy, head of the family court at Bournemouth County Court. And that crook, who is not fit to be a judge, rubber-stamped a void order for possession on my home without any due process of law.
This is a home that you own outright.
Yes.
No mortgage.
I paid cash for that house in December 1993, and I had no idea what had actually happened until it started to unravel after I got this shocking order for possession saying I had to vacate my house by 4 p.m. on the 29th of July 2015. Can you imagine?
How much notice did they give you?
It was equivalent to about 3 weeks.
Three weeks.
I was absolutely panicked at first because I was still bewildered and I didn't know what they'd done. And in that time, I found out what had happened. I'd had a crooked solicitor use my ID and my address. He was acting for the vendor of the house and he basically stole the freehold title of the house. And he stole all my purchase money. I only discovered this because I found out from going to Northern Rock, where the money was parked, to buy the house for cash, that the money had been taken on the day we were given vacant possession, but we didn't get any consideration for that. So we didn't get the title, the freehold title, transferred to our names, which is what's supposed to happen.
So and how did what happened with the land registry then?
Well, this guy, David Webb, he'd created this false... deed. He basically created a fake lease, which was didn't spot it at first. It was my mum who spotted it in January 2015. That it was on a fake title number, and it had an extra digit added on it. And all land registry could say to me was that it was erroneous. And John Pownall, who's supposed to be the head of litigation for England and Wales, said to me, oh, well, I can correct it. I said, well, how? I said, the slip rule under your rule says you've got 56 days. And he looks to the guy next to him and said, is that right? You know, he didn't even know the rules. He's supposed to be in charge of litigation. He said that to me, but he was actually the land registrar. And I told him I was coming to see him in December, December 2015. So, yeah, we spotted the fake title in 2016. He told me that I told him I was coming to see him in December in 2015. And he said, oh, no, you don't need to come. I said, yes, I do. I want to know what's been going on. And he said, well, I'm no longer the land registrar. And I said, what? How can you not be the land registrar? Why have you suddenly relinquished your post? And he said, I said, what are you? And he said, I'm the head of land registry for England and Wales. I thought, that is so suspicious. And sure enough, when I got there, I was treated like dirt, very cagey. They were withholding documents. My mother was with me. She kept saying, where is the freehold? Who's got the freehold? And he kept pointing like to the computer, but he wouldn't show us the freehold. And then he said, well, documents have been destroyed. And we said, what? You've destroyed documents? And I'm sorry to say this, but I think there's a big problem with land registry in England. I think there's a want of probity there. I'm not sure they're being straight with the public. I think there's some shenanigans going on, to put it politely.
I mean, a lot of people at home. I mean, I did a recent posting on Facebook, and I said to people, do you know you're going to have your house at the end of the day, even if it's registered with the Land Registry? Because we'd heard a tale not so long ago about somebody having it removed by the police, of all people, off the Land Registry, and they own the property outright.
There's something very strange with Land Registry. I actually don't trust Land Registry. I think they should be overhauled. This 2002 Land Registration Act has created a hotbed of fraud, everything electronic. It's very hard to identify veracity of electronic documents, isn't it? And they seem to be in on all kinds of irregularities that are happening with property assets, illegal asset transference of properties. I think it was in Twitter, actually, in January this year, 2018, that Andy Verity, from the producer of Panorama, he actually made a very interesting tweet that I think it was 23,000 properties from England have been funneled into the BVI and foreign ownership, corporate ownership. And I'm thinking, oh, gosh, how is that happening? And I do wonder whether that's happening through shell companies provided by the likes of Eversheds, who've got these umbrella companies set up, ever director and ever secretary, which have got thousands and thousands of shell companies under their umbrella. And there's all sorts of, it's like a parallel universe, you know, there's asset stripping going on a monumental scale, which is not being reported. People are being ejected and forced out of their homes on fake paperwork, using false instruments, fake accounts, and book entries.
Is anything going through the courts at all on this?
They use the courts to launder the money. And I, many people have said, and I join them, the British courts aren't fit for purpose. They're demonstrably unfit for purpose because there's a huge problem with, you know, at the end of the day, we're all human. Judges are human beings. You know, they err. They err. There's some of them are dishonest. They're, you know, feet of clay. We can't think. You see, everything in England's operating on the presumption, the wrongful presumption, that judges are whiter than white, that everybody's honest and everybody's upstanding. And unfortunately, that's not the reality.
Well, they're judging us, aren't they?
Yeah. And unfortunately, it's been turned into a kind of dishonest gravy train in certain courts. And I think the higher up you go, the more you've got to watch your back, because some absolutely shocking stuff going on.
So I think you've got some documents to show us, haven't you?
Yeah, I'd like to show you how this horror started with...
Is that document
Bank
number two?
Yeah, document number two is basically supposed to be a bank statement. Sorry about all the writing on it. But it was nothing more than a book entry. This is supposed to prove that I received a loan of 345,000 sterling. The fact is, I never got a penny. The fact is, the reason I never got a penny is because it was a scam being run by Fraser Mackay. And Fraser Mackay was the head auditor of HBOS. And he worked there 34 years.
Has he retired now?
He retired back in 2002. In 2001, he left the bank when he found out all the monies he was illegally pooling in offshore accounts around the world were frozen by the American authorities, the SEC. And he bolted out the door, and they set about bringing a kind of scapegoat, Shin Ganga, who's in prison now as we speak, and he was one of his agents, and Mackay had about 35 agents. But anyway, this document, as you can see, it says 345,000 withdrawals, and then it says payoffs. But the problem with this document is it was a fake account, and I didn't know this. And I only found this out in 2013. And I was told by, after lots and lots of waiting and being put through to different people, I was told that the account was, they didn't recognise it, and they asked me again, and then they said, admitted that that there was no drawdown against my name. And this is showing a drawdown. I don't know where that money went to, by the way. And then essentially that shortly after that, the following month, I had gone to the Financial Ombudsman. They intervened, and document one, this letter arrived referring to this account of document two, which is showing the same sort code, 122456, which was the Manchester office where Fraser Mackay, head auditor of HBOS PLC, was a director.
What's missing off that letter?
What's missing is the account number, because they tell me they couldn't put it in writing if the account didn't exist. So that's why it says 0000, but it does have the sort code. And they said they're satisfied that the account was opened fraudulently and that my credit rating would be restored. And I thought that would happen. Unfortunately, it didn't happen, because Eversheds, who were lurking on the scene since 2008, misled the bank through John Pownall at Land Registry, because what actually happened was I remember calling John Pownall in 2013 around May and saying, like an excited Labrador puppy, I said, I've found out that the bank accounts are not on the ledger, and I keep getting this, you know, they can't find them on the system. And then, of course, I got the proper evidence in 2013. I've got it all on tape. And he said to me, later in the year, in September, I found out. And he said, who told you that? And he wanted the names. And I said, oh, is that so you can take this false charge off the register? And he went, yes. Anyway, he deceived me, because he went straight back to Tim Pyle of Eversheds. Tim Pyle was a partner at Eversheds. He now works at Hambro's Bank. Totally crooked solicitor. And
have any of these people been to court at all through this scam?
He used to turn up at court, sit very sheepishly and quiet at the back, and then he bolted out the door, Pyle did, in January 2015, when it was a few weeks after I discovered that the accounts were all fake. I discovered actually the first inkling in 2013, but in 2014, I discovered that the claim that Tim Pyle had purported to bring against us had never begun in law. I'll come on to that in a minute. And that's why he bolted out the door, because if a claim is not actually issued by the court, then if it's not sealed by the court, it's not been issued. And if it's not been issued, it's not begun. And if it's not issued, there's no service. They have to have a certificate of service to show they've delivered it to you and that all parties have it. And then they open up what's called a case management file, but they never did that. And this is the scam. They deceived my husband and I for best part of 10 years through HM Courts. It's an absolute scandal. It's scurrilous. We've been deceived into attending the courts under false pretenses that we were debtors and that we owed this money and that they were acting for Bank of Scotland. It turns out they were acting for this shadow bank, calling itself Bank of Scotland, but it was really trading under this name In Parallel Solutions. And
so basically, corrupt solicitors are working hand in glove with shadow banking.
Shadow, yeah, exactly. It's the solicitors that are the facilitators of the frauds. The banks couldn't do it on their own. They depend on the legal mafia. They depend on dishonest, disreputable solicitors who just, you know, milking the gravy train to make money off false instruments. Because, you know, basically a fake bank account, a fake bank statement is a false instrument. A fake bank account is an instrument. And I was so gobsmacked when I found out that account was actually fake, because I'd actually paid, like an idiot, something like nearly £101,000 interest into it on the lie that there was an investment set up in our names by Fraser Mackay, which he was the trustee over, which didn't exist. And he did this to everyone. So the question is, how many millions of pounds has Fraser Mackay stolen through these fake accounts?
So how many people, did you mention you were part of a whistleblowing team of 400 people? Have you got a group of people?
No,
together?
There were 400 victims in this particular fraud. It was called the Vavasseur fraud. And a Vavasseur was a company set up in the Bahamas in the mid-90s. And there was two phases of it. And it was Vavasseur part Mark One was run out of New York originally, in America, and then there were some problems that took place, and the people of the operators who worked with Fraser Mackay in the 90s, I believe, then passed the bomb over to Dobb White, Midlands accounting firm. Shin Ganga and Alan White were the two partners, and they're in prison now as we speak. They were in prison for conspiracy to defraud and bribing a US official in 2008, after an eight-month jury trial before Justice Langstaff at the Birmingham Crown Court, where I was a vital witness and I gave evidence for about a week. And I can honestly say, hand on heart, if I'd known then what I know now, I would have given my evidence completely differently. I discovered that Fraser MacKay had gone in as a witness for the prosecution counsel, can you believe? And he was running the fraud.
Really?
All the evidence points to the fact that Fraser MacKay was running the heist, the fraud. The money disappeared. The SFO issued a press release in April 2008 saying that there's over $200 million still missing. It was routed through an umbrella company, which I found out was a Phoenix company in the Isle of Man. And behind that was the Planaway Investment Services, which they were running. And he was siphoning all the money into hedge funds and all kinds of places. Because I don't know if you know, once banks get their hands on the money and they do what they want with it, they create more money with the collateral, the seed capital, and they ended up stealing not just the uplift and the money they created, the fiat money. They leverage it. It's a fraction of what they create. So if they've got £1 million tranche, they then create like 10 million. And then when they finish that cycle, they do the same thing again. But they also stole the seed capital. That's how greedy they were. So now if anyone's wondering where bankers are getting all their bonuses from, this is how they do it. They're generating it from seed capital, from stolen money, basically. And the secret was that they got title of people's money. And it's against the Financial Service Markets Act 2000. I think it's Client Asset Security Rule 7.5, which states that any money sent offshore must be in the account holder's name so that there's no money laundering. And of course, they weren't doing that. And the bank was not adhering to these rules. And of course, James Crosby, the CEO at the time, I found out to my horror, he had about 50 companies, a whole conglomerate of companies. I did a rough total. It was turning over billions of pounds a month. He had acquisition companies, merger companies, Crosby Homes, while he was CEO of HBOS. That's the man who was squirming before Andrew Tyrie in 2009 from the Treasury Select Committee. And I think Andrew Tyrie had to ask him about 7 times, were you reckless? I mean, total villainy. I mean, these corrupt bankers, and none of them are qualified. It's like, what? How can they not be qualified? You know,
he wasn't a Methodist minister as well, was he?
Well, I heard that, was it?
Co-op, wasn't it?
Andy Hornby, wasn't he I know one of them was a barrow boy. I mean, they didn't really have any qualifications between them. And that played out in what how they ran this bank to the ground. And I rang up Lloyds Banking Group before the merger and warned them, spoke for about 20 minutes about what I knew. And I said it would be catastrophic if you merged with Lloyds. Why are you going to contaminate Lloyds Banking Group? And this sort of man in a grey suit just listened very, very quietly. And then after I'd finished, he just said, thank you. Off goes the phone. They didn't give a damn. They had made their minds up. It was a done deal. It was done and dusted. It was a dishonest merger. They knew they'd had a secret bailout of £25.7 billion from the Bank of England before the merger. Did you know that? They'd had a secret bailout because HBOS was trading while insolvent. If any of us traded while we were insolvent, you know, we'd probably go to prison for it. These guys just got away with blue murder and then get a secret bailout from the Bank of England. What on earth is going on in this country? That's what I ask myself. But
you know what's so shocking about this story is that it just highlights how corrupt the banks are. And, you know, we were talking about my past working for a financial charity a few years ago. And I was on the all-party parliamentary group for educating young people about saving and not going into debt. And you had all these big names, all these big banks and building societies, insurance companies. They were putting money in to a charity that helped to get the teachers and the kids educated. But they don't stand a chance. I mean, the kids of today do not stand a chance. The adults don't stand a chance of fighting this tyranny with the banks.
It is tyranny. It's exactly that. It's tyranny, despotism. And it's sanctioned by government because the government is asleep at the wheel because it's not affecting them directly. They're making money off it for the professions. You know, I think I read the Legal Services Commission are making the legal profession, the Law Society, I think they're making £28 billion profit a year. I think that was the figure. I read it in a white paper recently. But anyway, it's into the tens of billions. It's over £20 billion profit. And for them, it's just a gravy train. You know, I guess they're making it by collecting fees from solicitors who are members. And then now, instead of the SRA, who I've had the most shocking run-in with, they're the most unbelievable
SRA fake
regulators. They're supposed to be the Solicitors Regulatory Authority. Right. They've got this code of conduct. It's totally disingenuous. They ignore all their own codes. You should see some of the letters I've had. It's just so... it's such a wind-up. You just think, how dare they do this to us? These are their members, and I've got friends who've had the same problem, and they say, we're only here to protect our members. You know, they're lying, they're deceiving the public that they're regulators. They're not. They're protecting the criminal acts of their members.
Have you got some more documents for us?
Yeah, I just want to quickly talk about these fake accounts. The Bank of Scotland actually opened up 6 fake accounts in my name. They started off with this one, the 122456 sort code, where they pretended they'd given us 345,000 by a book entry. Have you ever heard of anybody being given a loan by a transfer on a piece of paper? This is theft by pen and paper. Fake accounts. They rely on this as the evidence, so-called. I should have got the other document next time and show you the so-called ledger. It's not even legible. It's just a scramble of, you know, marks on a sheet of paper. And it was admitted as evidence by Martin Dancy to take my house. I said, would you have your house taken on that piece of paper?
And Martin Dancy is?
He was the Bent County Court judge who ordered repossession of my house without jurisdiction of the court. Now, this is the shocking thing. In late 2017, I went to a top Manchester law firm and found out, after all my papers had been scrutinised, that the claim had never started against us because the original... claim for possession set up by Tim Pyle of Eversheds in 2008 was never sealed. So if the claim isn't sealed, then it hasn't started. It's not been issued, and there was no issuance, no service, and I didn't realise. And I spotted in 2014 there was no seal, but I didn't realise that no seal meant no issuance, and no issuance means no jurisdiction. And if there's no jurisdiction of the court.
They
haven't got the right to even get you in there. And that's why they have to have shadow courts. Because what's happened is, and I want the public to really get this, shadow banking has created shadow courts.
So because you've got parallel courts now.
Yeah, because a shadow bank is running a false debt created out of thin air on fake numbers in an account that's not on the ledger of the bank, so it's not audited. It's ultra vires. Outside the system. Therefore, it's not regulated. And if it's not regulated, it's not registered. And if it's not registered, no one's got any remit of it. So the Financial Ombudsman actually has got no remit over unregulated debt. And this is the scam.
So who runs these parallel courts then?
Well, they're happening inside HM courts. And I guarantee it's true. I've noticed what the other people have had the same thing. They turn up and they see this case number. Which there's no case management files for. They see the parties. And I saw there were 2 listings, 2 different rooms on the 30th of June 2015 when all this scam happened. Same parties, same case number, same day, same time, but 2 different courtrooms. I went into the shadow court before Martin Dancy. He kept us waiting 4 hours. I had about 12 people with me, eyewitnesses, because I knew that it was all unlawful. And he obviously realised he had a bit of a problem, so he wanted to use up the time so he didn't show his face. And eventually we went in at about after 2:15 in the afternoon. And I said to the man sitting at the front, I didn't recognise, and I said to this barrister, Paul Mitchell, at the time working at Hailsham Chambers, he's now at 4 New Square, total crook. He's got risen to QC status. I said to him, who's this man? And he said, that's David Webb. I said, oh, you're David Webb, the man who kept pretending to be my solicitor.
And putting
the phone down on me. No, David Webb was the solicitor who stole my purchase money, I discovered.
Right.
And he stole it behind the scenes from Northern Rock by getting the passbook and using an accomplice to collect the passbook from me on the 3rd of December, 1993. And I've actually got a fake cash statement that was given, which I didn't study at the time because I was bathing my baby. And it was quite late, it was very late afternoon, it was early evening. and I was distracted, and that's obviously why they did it then. And he said, there's a contract race on the house you're wanting to buy. I need to show them that you're a cash buyer. Have you got a passbook? And I said, oh, yes. I showed him the passbook. He said, oh, can I borrow it? I'll bring it back. I never actually got it back. And I didn't think of the passbook as being cash, which was, where was my head? I don't know where my head was in those days, but that was a crazy thing to have done, is given my passbook. But anyway, that's how they emptied my passbook, paid off three debts of the vendor of my house on the day we were given vacant possession. And the rest is history. We were deceived that we acquired this house, and they told us, they didn't give us the papers. They said, oh, the completion statement and the paperwork will follow in the new year. It's not ready yet. And I thought, oh, okay. You know, we were in 9 days before Christmas. I can remember chasing it a few times, but I didn't rumble that there was a huge fraud in progress. And this is how they did it. So David Webb was the solicitor behind the scenes acting for the vendor who basically stole all my money from Northern Rock. And he only found this out in 2016. And Northern Rock sent me an email. Jane Ann Gardier, now trading as Virgin Money, said, we can't account for that money. We know we didn't have your signature. This is what's happening. A major bank like Northern Rock can't account for the money that went out. £203,000 taken out of that account.
Did they think you were not going to notice?
I thought I wasn't going to notice. They actually took out £185,000 initially, because in three tranches. And I found at Land Registry the correlative evidence, which was correlating evidence, which was basically three transactions had been paid off on that day, totaling the same amount of the vendor. That's probably why he got out the house and gave up the house. But I got nothing. In other words, there was no what's called consideration under the Bill of Exchange Act 1882. We have to have consideration. You give something of value, you get something of value, supposedly. And it didn't happen. So I wasn't very well at the time. I had disability. I was actually registered epileptic at the time. Thankfully, I'm not now. But I suffered it for 20 years. And I just had cognitive problems then. And, you know, they knew I was disabled. They must have seen me coming. And this is what happened. It's that easy for white-collar criminals masquerading as court officers, because every solicitor is an officer of the court. Every court staff working there is an officer of the court. Barristers are officers of the court. And they are doing some of the worst, heinous crimes in human history. What the heck is going on? There's no penalty, it seems, that, you know, really people who are in high rank, who breach public trust and breach their position, should be very, very heavily penalised with jail sentences and, you know, heavy fines. But because we seem to have a no-touch regulatory system in England, and the worst of it is that all these so-called regulators like the Financial Ombudsman Service and the Solicitors Regulatory Authority and the Information Commission Office and the whole, you know, whole enchilada, the whole lot of them, that none of them say they've got a remit to cover fraud. The minute you mention the F word, they say you've got to go to the police. Now, what do we do when the police don't police?
Well, they're not equipped, though, are they? They don't have always the expertise, do they? Or well, they're stretched.
The police, there's a budget issue, but there's also another logistical issue, which, again, is not being addressed by Treasury. And a number of people, I'm sure, will come forward, and I invite you to come forward if you're a witness to this. But I've heard that police are getting easy loans, free loans, loans they wouldn't otherwise be entitled to, from the major banks who are using these shadow accounts to buy favours from the police to keep shtum, to keep quiet. And if you think
That's
about it, it's kind of stands to reason, because, you know, it's like, you know, they're thinking about their retirement. I wonder how many slush funds exist with the police. I'm sorry to say it, but I'm disgusted with Britain's policing. It is so corrupt. We seem to have a very corrupt infiltration across the 46 corporations calling themselves police forces. Dorset Police is one of the worst. I've had the most terrible time. In all these years, over 13, 14 years, they've refused to investigate my case. Anthony Stansfeld, who's my hero, and he's the most amazing, remarkable, upstanding crime commissioner for Thames Valley Police.
How come he got involved? Because you don't live in his area.
I don't live in his area, but he was behind the jailing of the HBOS mobsters in the Reading Quayside fraud in February 2017. And I was so impressed with the work he'd done, and, you know, in finally convicting these bankers. Although really they should go after James Crosby because he was the beast at the top.
What happened to him in the end?
I don't know. I'd quite like to know. He seems to be in hiding. I think he had to surrender his knighthood, or it was taken off him in 2013 because he quadrupled the bank's profits on paper using what I've been describing, heists through the shadow banking, private banking unit, which is a hotbed for fraud. And nobody's dealt with it. The PRA should be dealing with this. The FCA should be dealing with it.
The PRA standing for?
The Prudential Regulatory Authority, part of the government. They're like the highest ranking.
Mainly actuaries, aren't
they? They're on a par with the Treasury. Bank of England doesn't seem to want to know. I'm sure they know that people are being stolen from. You know, we are having our assets raided and illegally stripped from us using false paperwork and big name law firms. Anyway, this fake account, this 122456,
which document number is that?
Number two. Was migrated a further five times. And the latest account was apparently opened in November 2011. And I'd like you to turn to document six.
And document six, the last one.
And document five. Basically, if you look at document six, you'll see what a counterfeit bank statement looks like.
Document six.
There's no phone number showing. There's no fax number showing. It says branch name, specialist banking unit. What does that mean? What does that mean, specialist banking unit? It says my name and my husband's name. It's got our address. This is what I mean about identity theft. We didn't open this account. They migrated it on their own volition, a private cabal operating in the private banking unit under the wing of Fraser Mackay, who carried on the cover-up for 18 years so far. He took early retirement. He went round the world on trekking holidays. Please Google HBOS Nick Wallis, W-A-L-L-I-S. I did a documentary with Ian Fraser, the renowned author of Shredded, Fred the Shred from RBS, Royal Bank of Scotland, in 2014. It was broadcast on the 3rd of March 2014. If you look at that documentary, you'll see there's lots of slants where it says there's no suggestion Fraser Mackay knew it was a fraud. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the following year after it was broadcast, I found out that Fraser Mackay was running the fraud, and I got his transcripts.
How did you manage that?
I had to pay a lot of money for them. And I had a devil of a job getting them. But
His transcripts
from the Crown Court trial, where he pretended to be a witness for the prosecution counsel. Right. And he was really the protagonist. And I think what has happened is he turned the Queen's evidence.
Right.
If anyone wants to know what does it mean, turn the Queen's evidence, it looks that he gave himself up on the 12th of August 2002 to the Serious Fraud Office. And said, right,
squealed
and said, protect me, I'll tell you everything.
Did he?
And in return, he got protection from the Serious Fraud Office, and they should be called the Serious Farce Office because they totally screwed it up. What actually happened is he didn't tell everything. He withheld the fact that he'd been opening and running fake accounts, and he set up an unknown number of shadow accounts in people's names, including six in our name and two in my sister's name, and he basically was charging interest to dozens of victim clients. He turned the clients into victims, charging interest on these loans that weren't on the ledger of the bank. And where did the interest go? Into the shadow account, which was supposedly called a servicing account.
It's interesting there are no phone numbers on these documents.
It is. But what's interesting about Exhibit 6 is look at the balance. It says £407,024.19 OD, overdrawn.
That was document 6, was it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you imagine getting that in the post in your name and you never even opened that account? You've never seen it in your life and you think, what the heck's this? And I rang up the bank straight away on getting that in 2013. That's how I discovered this horror story. And they said, there's no such account. They said, there's not enough digits. Look at the numbers, 0535318. Not enough digits. Hallmarks of fraud. Lloyds Bank, if you're watching this, Perhaps you'd like to listen to the 300 plus tapes that I have of your of phone calls with you where your staff have just banged the phone down on me. Bang the phone down. You say
they used to speak to you, didn't they?
They are hideously corrupt. They ring up and I ring them up and I say, I've had this bank account open in mine and my husband's name that we didn't mandate. What is this? They bankrupted me on the back of this fake account. How can you bankrupt somebody on a fake account? That's the insolvency service for you. I think they should be called the insolent service, not the insolvency service.
So have we got any more documents left to see?
Well, I can bring them, but I, you know, we thought we should limit them because the timing for this. But the fact is, this is the account they've used to brand my husband and I bankrupt. We're not bankrupt. We're not insolvent. That was done through a shadow court, driven by Richard Pitt, who is a successor to Timothy Pyle. Richard Pitt is currently practicing as a partner in the Cardiff office. They seem to get all the, you know, the toxic banking waste. They pick up, you know, fake instruments off the financial scrap heap.
Is this HBOS?
This is Eversheds.
Eversheds.
Eversheds are pursuing victims for alleged debts which are based on false instruments, fake accounts, which don't exist, and the people have never had a penny. We've never had a penny from Bank of Scotland. How come they were trying to take my house? I was forced into entering an appeal process knowing that there was no court seal, document 3. The court actually confirmed, they said it's noted that they did not have a court seal. Having confirmed that, the court should have struck it out straight away under their own civil procedure rules. You know, they've got a mandatory duty. If a claim's never been sealed by the court, the only way they can get round it is within getting sanction under CPR 3.9.
That's document 3,
CPR 3.9, but it requires a process they have to go through, like a mini trial under CPR 3.10, and that never happened. So that the fraudulent order from Martin Dancy failed to take into account. There was no protocol followed under CPR 3.10. And as the High Court Judge Edith said in July 2015, the court has to have jurisdiction in the first place. They never had jurisdiction because they never issued the claim, so it never started in law. Without jurisdiction, all of the orders they've written in the past 10 years are void,
who
nullity.
Did not bear a seal.
Yeah, they're all
so
void orders.
People need to check that, don't they, when they go to court?
They have to check not just that the seal is there, they have to ask for the case management electronic files, and if they haven't got the caseman files, and if they haven't got the proof of the forensic proof of the actual audited debt, I mean, as I say, this was the fifth migration, but they have to put it through a financial channel, and they've obviously, the bank told me in 2013 this was somebody else's debt, Gavin and Eileen Stewart, and they said that it had been migrated in error just after the merger in 2011. That was what they told me, and that they'd restore my position and put it right. And Eversheds intercepted and stopped that happening. That's a firm of solicitors perverting the course of justice to protect criminals inside of HBOS PLC, now trading as Lloyds Banking Group.
So today, to wrap this story up, where are you with this case now?
I'd like to just mention Exhibit 4. I won 3 times. This is before I realised it was all a hoax, that the proceedings were a nullity. And this was from Sir Richard Buxton, who used to be the head of the Queen's Bench. And you can see that he says in the highlighted section that the notoriety in banking circles of Dob White, that was the two accountants that are still in jail. The interesting thing about Shin Ganga and Alan White is they were agents of Fraser Mackay. And I found the name of all the agents. I've got them on a list. There's 35 of them, and they were all mostly from IFAs, independent financial advisors, to give credibility to what they were doing, which was conning people that this was the best thing since sliced bread and that there was this tremendous business opportunity, investment opportunity, endorsed by Bank of Scotland. This is how they missold it, that it was basically had the backing of James Crosby at board level. And it turned out it was a massive heist. It was organised crime. It was a big, fat Ponzi scheme circulating the same bunch of money. There was 28 banks involved. I've got the numbers and accounts of all of them all around the world. This is Fraser Mackay. He's got a hell of a lot to answer to. I hope he's the next one to go down. He's another Lyndon Scarfield who denied everything right to the bitter end. It ended up costing Thames Valley Police £7 million to pursue and nail the fraudsters inside of HBOS PLC, David Mills, Michael Bancroft, Lyndon Scowfield and others. This is a parallel situation which happened through In Parallel Solutions earlier than the Reading Quayside fraud, which has had a lot of publicity. Reading Quayside targeted small and medium enterprises. Vavasor Dobb White targeted retail high net worth clients. They called me and my sister high net worth because we didn't have any mortgages. We didn't have any genuine mortgages. Webb had created various mortgages which I didn't know about at the time. And I can prove that they're all fake. Because Webb had four banks involved.
Well, you've got a lot of people watching this who think they're it's not going to happen to them because they own their houses outright. Mm. But you've shown today that in actual fact, you're just as likely.
It could happen to anyone. I would say to anyone watching this, check the records at Land Registry. Make sure there's no uninvited charges on there. Because to put a charge on a property that you have to grant the deed, you, the equitable title holder, have to grant the deed.
Banks keep a lot of the deeds.
Yeah. But the fact is, there's the equitable title and there's the legal title. Only the equitable title holder can grant the legal title. So the legal title is an inferior title. But what's happening is these crooks inside the banks who are working hand in glove with big name law firms and bent solicitors. I'm not saying they're all bent, but there's some very good solicitors, don't get me wrong. But I've lost confidence in the legal profession because of my experiences with them, because they all seem to be perpetuating this nightmare that's gone on for nearly a decade. I'm still in my house, thankfully. And the reason I'm still in my house is because I've fought them tooth and nail, and I've actually gone the forensic route. And I've said, show me the money. When did I get the loan? Show me the signature and the original mandate of authority that entitled you to open up these accounts and migrate them without telling me. This is like a runaway train. It's like autopilot. This is what they're doing. How many people have got a shadow account? The only way to find out is to say to the bank, I invoke my rights under the Bankers Book Evidence Act 1879. That entitles you under strict conditions to inspect the original ledger of the bank, which has to record every single mortgage and every single account that is opened in anybody's name, because that's supposed to be what is audited.
And how much does this cost you in legal fees, as a matter of interest?
I just shudder to think. It's what it's cost me in my health, my family life, my relationships, my married relationship. You know, I haven't been able to live with my husband. We've been targeted. You know, we had to take our lives separate ways because he couldn't stand it. It made him ill. It gave him cancer. You know, I was nursing him in a foreign country in 2016. It was all stress induced. He just couldn't hack it. You know, we were being voraciously pursued by hyena solicitors at Eversheds. Richard Pitt, currently, who's still going strong. He's done the same scam on my sister. Lots of fake orders. Paul Mitchell, barrister, I found out, has been creating fraudulent orders in the name of various judges, impersonating judges. This is an incredibly serious offence. They're not sealed.
So basically, we'll wrap this up now, and we'll just leave it at the fact that you are still in your house.
I'm still in my house by
despite
the grace of God.
Everything, by the grace of God.
I've taken a stand in truth. I stand in truth. These people are cowards. When it comes, the push comes to the shove, they're out the door. None of them want to answer. Eversheds refused to give me any disclosure of any evidence. I said to them, where's the contract? Where's the contract? They haven't got a contract. The civil court, the county courts are civil courts. Civil courts rely on the law of contract. You have to have a contract to enforce it in a court. Otherwise, there's no cause of action.
So when you see,
the hell's going on? You know,
so, I mean, I fought for Brexit, and it's been the banking, the financial industry in particular, which has been vociferous in saying we want to remain in the EU and protect our situation in the City of London. What would you have to say to those bankers now?
I just think it's a big distraction campaign. I think what really matters is you know, we've all got the same needs. We all need a home. We all need clean water. We all need clean air. We all need land to grow crops. We don't want GM foods, which turn into Frankenstein, you know, vegetables which cause cancer and so on. We don't want contaminated water with fluoride from the chimney scrubbers, you know, that's being toxic waste being dumped into our water supply.
We don't want 5G either.
We don't want 5G, which is causing stillborn. You're telling me the horrors of that. We don't want to be owned and controlled by
global elite,
an incompetent state, which is faceless. You know, we all need a home. If it was happening to them, it would be a different story. If it was their kids being stolen, they're stealing our children, they're contaminating our water, they're poisoning our skies. These chemtrails, these toxic chemtrails, these oblique lines that you see in the sky on a beautiful sunny day, and you think, what's that? And you know, you can see them going crisscross all over. And I think, what are they doing? Is this just experimenting on the human race to see if we drop dead? You know, why are so many children now autistic and suffering ADHD in our schools? There's a massive upsurge in
cancers, one in two
illnesses
now,
and cancers, and even knifings from this 5G, which is causing people to go loopy and murderers.
And the mental health, that, you know.
I honestly think it's because they've been deceiving the British people for so long, and the inhabitants of these lands, you know, our rights are not being upheld. I mean, it breaks my heart. I mean, I just feel very, very passionate about exposing this, what's happening. There is no law in England that allows a mortgagee to dispossess a property from a mortgagor. No law supports it. What is going on? We are the creditors. We are the creditors. They are the debtors. When you play Monopoly and you turn over Mayfair or Pall Mall and you mortgage it and you release the money and you build the houses or whatever, you know, when you pay it off, you can turn it back and use it again. And that's actually when you can buy the houses again, of course. But the fact is, it's still your property. Just because you mortgaged it, it's still yours. The bank can't repossess it because they didn't possess it in the first place. And I've got some very good links, if anyone's interested, to really study this, to get your head around it, because they are conning us in the banks. They are reversing the roles. They're turning the tables. They are deceiving people that they owe money. Banks do not lend money. They issue credit. It's a different thing. Issuing credit is what I showed you on that exhibit with the, you know, the first one. Was it number one or number two? Sorry, I'm just trying to find it now. Yes, it's exhibit number
Well, basically, they're not lending out any of their own money.
They're not lending out their own money. They are using your money. And they're facilitating credit to be created. But the trouble is, they're not obeying their own rules. They're disregarding, the Law of Property Act, miscellaneous provisions, 1989. And they're just departing from the laws that are meant to protect us.
Right. To summarise then, so to the audience at home, thank you for listening. I hope you found this story thought-provoking. Check your documents with the Land Registry. We know it's all going digitised. Check that your solicitor is not trying to defraud you. Check your bank. Check you're not being involved in this parallel shadow banking system. And a message to the government. We're out to get you. You cannot
hold you to account.
We're going to hold you to account. And I would urge everybody who's watching this today to write to their MP, make their lives difficult, clog up their inboxes, because we're coming for you next. Thank you, Liz.
Lovely to meet you.
I'm sure we're going to have another chat.
Yes,
very shortly.
Thank you very much.
And thank you all to you at home. This was another Stepping Stones interview to awareness, and I hope you've enjoyed listening. Thank you and good night.